for arts and learning. And the first thing to do today is to, this is a bilingual session. So we need to find out if there are folks who need help. We've got a very experienced translator interpreter with us, Dominique, who will help us with working between French and English. So est-ce qu'il y a quelqu'un qui veut avoir traduction, interprétation? I'll turn it over to Dom. Dom, could you explain it?
Yeah, okay. Alors, bonjour à tout le monde. Hi, everyone. My name is Dominique Denis. I'm the translator for CNAL. Je suis le traducteur et maintenant interprète simultané pour le réseau canadien des arts et d'apprentissage, pour les arts et d'apprentissage. Aujourd'hui, on voulait avoir une réunion, une table ronde bilingue dans la mesure du possible. Évidemment, on est soucieux de votre temps. Et donc, on va essayer de trouver des solutions qui sont à la fois pratiques et respectueuses des deux groupes linguistiques représentés. Il ne sera pas nécessairement question de multiplier par deux en traduction toutes les interventions et toutes les questions. Mais je m'adresse surtout, bien sûr, aux francophones parmi vous. Et j'aimerais savoir, est-ce que vous aimeriez, premièrement, est-ce que vous avez besoin que certaines des interventions ou certaines choses vous soient traduites, ou est-ce que votre maîtrise de l'anglais vous permet de suivre ce que vos collègues à travers le pays vont dire?
Thank you. Okay, so to get started, we will basically go around the room. First, I'm going to just talk a little bit about Zoom here. Many of you are probably very familiar with it at this point. I know a lot of people are using it right now in their practice. But I just wanted to just go through a couple of things that need mentioning for this particular session. If you would like to participate in the discussion, we ask that you enable your video. And then you will show up and we will kind of, as we go around the room and introduce everybody, you'll be part of that. Also at the bottom, there is a menu. If you pull it up, you can see there's participants. If you click on that, then on the right-hand side, a menu will come up, shows everybody who's in the discussion. And, in that menu as well, on the right-hand side, you can also see the option to raise hand. So as we get going in the discussion, you can raise your hand and then virtually, and I will know to call on you in sequence. If you can't figure it out, that's okay. You can also just wave and we'll get to you as well. Also, there is a chat function at the bottom. So if you enable that, the chat has been great over the past, this is our 10th discussion so far. People have been posting links in the chat or making comments if they don't want to jump in on somebody else who's talking, or they want to get it out before they forget. You can add it in the chat. And also in the chat, you can send somebody a private message. So if you wanted to comment to them privately, or if you want to ask for somebody's contact information, then you can also do that through the chat. Also throughout the session, I will be launching a few polls, and that is just to give us some additional data for the reports that we will be writing, and letters that we will be writing as a result of these sessions. Just to let you know, these polls are completely confidential, so please do feel free to take part in that. And actually, I'll just send it back to Larry to kind of introduce the team and talk a little bit more about who we are. Sorry, Larry, trying to unmute you here. Oh, Larry, can't hear you. I'm having trouble unmuting you, actually. If you can unmute, there you go.
I unmuted, okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. I'm Larry O'Farrell, Chair of the Board of Directors of the Canadian Network for Arts and Learning. I want to welcome you and thank you very much for participating in this call. And my apologies for being a bit late. I was following my watch, which is running half an hour late. Ah, so that's never happened to any of you, of course. No. We have a wonderful team, and some of the team members are here, so I want to make sure you know who they are. You've been meeting already with Jennifer Petrelli, who's our managing director. Caitlin Bois is our database coordinator, and she is the person who builds our map of Arts and Learning of Canada, and she's the one who will do a lot of facilitating electronically here. Nisa Sills, there's Nisa, she's our researcher. So this call is being recorded, and you will be able to access it later. And Nisa is going to go through all of the, so it will be 11 of these sessions, and make a report. I don't know, we're going to talk about how you're going to do that, Nisa, on Tuesday, how she's going to do that, because it's a very huge job, but we'll figure out how to do that. There will be a report which will include sort of like the really the main threads of conversation, the issues people are facing, the solutions people are finding, the ideas people are having for how they can continue their work. Let me see, I don't see, Vicky Cummings, there's Vicky. Vicky Cummings is our Director of Strategic Partnerships. And so welcome to Vicky as well. Anybody else? Don't see any other of our team members. So, and then of course, thank you very much to Dom for being here to make sure that people don't have a problem with language.
Yeah. Larry, just one thing, since you were speaking of me, I took the opportunity to text in the chat bar the three people whom by name I could identify as francophone, Sophie, Odile, and Marie-Claude, and all three have indicated that they are perfectly comfortable following the conversation in English and asking questions should there be a need in English or making whatever statement they want in English as well, which is what I understand from our exchange. But I will be on the call for the whole time should there be a difference there or somebody would decide that they do want it. So just wanted to put that there.
Thank you very much. And yes, and my idea was, well, my experience with bilingual sessions is generally that you speak the language you want to speak and we'll cope, we'll make sure people understand. So thank you for that. I'll talk a little bit about the Canadian Network for Arts and Learning. We're a charitable foundation registered with the Canadian federal government now. We take as our mission to unite the field, to bring people together, the arts and learning field, for an exchange of research and best practices and advocacy ideas. We're really trying to promote the field, the sector of arts and learning in any way we can. And we happen to be, and we're very grateful that we're currently working on a grant from the Canada Council for the Arts on digital strategies. And we were not able to have our in-person meetings, as is the case with so many people. And this is, then Jennifer got the idea, why don't we try to reach everybody across the country digitally? And this has been a really satisfying, a tremendously encouraging response. And so thank you all for participating. I'm now going to turn it over to Jennifer, who will make sure that we're able to access the Zoom. And then Jennifer will be the one who will help us to work our way through who speaks and when.
Thank you, Larry. So again, if you would like to take part in the conversation, please do just enable your video. And if you aren't able to enable your video, you can message me or unmute yourself if you'd like to speak. And it is best if everyone stays muted unless you are talking. So don't be offended if I mute you and we'll hopefully be able to get everybody unmuted in a good way here. So we're going to start off, if you could just say your name and your title or the job that you do, if that's with an organization or not, and also a sentence or two about how the current situation has affected you and the work that you do with the self-isolation and the social distancing, etc. So we'll start off with Garrett. There we go.
Hey, I'm Garrett from the Hamilton Music Collective in Hamilton, Ontario. I'm the marketing coordinator. I spend a lot of my time teaching children to play music. So we have about 700 students in our partner elementary schools where we teach them free music. They get free music lessons. And we're a registered nonprofit as well. So right now, all of our teachers are self-isolating. We have about 15 teachers that are all contracted. And yeah, we're switching to online learning. So we've already uploaded a bunch of videos that our teachers have recorded at home. We'll be continuing with that daily and offering free one-on-one video lessons to our students. So that's the first initiative we've taken.
Great, thank you, Garrett. Holly.
Hi. Hi there, I'm Holly Corman. I'm a principal at an inner city school in Cambridge. And of course, we are definitely on lockdown now. And we've been working with a local community group to provide some different kinds of opportunities for our student population. It's K to six. And many of them live in the complex next to my school and cannot get out to arts events and activities. So this has certainly made it difficult for us because online is not something that many of our students can do either.
Great. Thank you, Holly. Janelle.
I am unmuted. Hi, my name is Janelle Shaw. I'm the Executive Director for Arts Accessibility Network Manitoba. The biggest challenge for us has been we've had to cancel quite a few exhibitions, and so we're just kind of trying to figure out how we can offer those odd exhibitions online as an alternative. Thanks.
Great, thank you. Julia?
Hi, my name is Julia Topple. I'm the theater school administrator and tour coordinator at Neptune Theater in Nova Scotia. Basically, all of our programs have had to be postponed or canceled due to class sizes and the fact that Nova Scotia's down to like a maximum of 5 people interacting. So right now we're looking into options for doing online video classes. We currently have theater challenges and performance challenges for kids and adults that we're offering for free. And we're just looking into how we can access this digital platform to work with our students.
Great, thank you, Julia. Kate.
Hi there, can you hear me? You can hear me? Hi, I'm Kate Wilcott. I am currently the Arts and Culture Coordinator for the City of St. John here in New Brunswick. But I'm now also the head volunteer at a performing arts school I started almost 20 years ago called Interaction. They offer theater classes, music classes, dance classes, film classes, basically anything that kids are interested in learning about, they teach. We just had a team meeting with all of the, I think there were about 15 teaching artists in the theater department, coming up with innovative. People keep saying best practices, but there's no best practices right now because we're trailblazing right now. Innovative ideas to put the courses online. We've been doing Zoom rehearsals and, well, they're not so much rehearsals as Zoom meetups with the kids, really just to give the kids some sense of normalcy and structure in their lives. So that's who I am. And Julia, I had your job about 25 years ago at Neptune, so hey.
Great, thank you. Kayla.
Hi, my name is Kayla. I work for the Northwest Territories Arts Program. It's a marketing initiative of the GNWT. Essentially, with the city basically shutting down, we've had to put a lot of our programming on hold, which it's hard because the creative economy here is very strong, and so we're just trying to navigate that like everybody else.
Great, thank you. Kim.
Hi, I'm Kim Palmer. I'm the executive director of the Okanagan School of the Arts in Penticton, BC. We're in a difficult situation right now because we also have a brick and mortar building that is closed to the public. We've lost all of our income from renting that venue for events and from all of our programming, which means that paying salaries and utility bills is a real challenge right now. We've already laid off our one other staff person. We are taking one of our courses online, but a lot of our courses are very hands-on or music-based, which if anyone's tried to use Zoom for a music rehearsal, not good. I see some agreement there. So yeah, we're definitely facing some challenges.
Great, thank you. Kirstie.
I'm Kirstie. I'm the executive director of the Kingston Arts Council in Kingston, Ontario. Similar to what's being expressed, I mean, we're certainly trying to figure out the best ways to support our community. That's our job at all times. And of course, this is a critical time. One of the initiatives we will be rolling out is a series of roundtables similar to what your organization is offering. And thank you very much for doing this. We had our first one today with some arts leaders in our community. We'll be rolling out a few other discipline-specific kind of conversations online, which we're hoping will provide an effort for people to come together and provide support, receive support, and really just chat about how we move forward from here and share resources and knowledge. Yeah, looking forward to learning about what everybody else is doing today. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Lily.
Hi, so my name is Lily. I am a high school teacher for the Ottawa-Carleton District School Board. I think for us, a huge challenge, at least at my school, is that a lot of the kids that are at our school, we have kids who are, I know it's not necessarily arts related, but we have a deaf and hard of hearing program. So for them, it's imperative that they have access to technology. All the computers are locked in the building. We're not allowed to go into the building. So even getting technology out to kids who either don't have it at home, or they have like one device and they're splitting it between like three or four siblings is hard. So I'm qualified to teach music. I do teach music with the Canada Music Academy. Currently, I don't have any students. So that transition, I guess, hasn't been that difficult. But for us, getting a device into the hands of kids who don't have them at home and really need them, like there are some families where it's more important that they figure out a way to get food on the table. So, yeah. And like next Monday is my last day of work. So because I was filling in for a teacher who was on medical leave, so it's a whole weird situation for me, but one day at a time, right? So yeah, that's great. Me.
Thank you, thank you. Marie-Claude.
Hi, my name is Marie-Claude Maton. I'm the executive and artistic director of the Canadian Music Competition. We are based in Montreal, but we do have auditions across the country. We have every year about 500 and more participants. This year is very difficult for us. We announced on March 16 that we were canceling our auditions in the 12 cities for the first round. At that time, 2 weeks ago, we thought that maybe we could have the auditions for the final in June. But things are changing very fast. Things have been canceled in Toronto up to June 30th. So we will make a decision beginning of next week, probably to postpone if we can in September. We had decided to invite all of our participants, but as we received no grant from the government, this is really impacting us. Our revenues are attached to our activities. We had sponsors that have been generous to support us in that context though, but still in uncertain times for us ahead of us. We are also concerned to me because we can notice that there is, we want to maintain motivations of our participants. We know that sometimes it gives a goal to participate in something like the Canadian Music Competitions. Now we feel that the people, the musicians are isolated. Sometimes they don't have access to the teachers or an accompanist, chamber music, it's really difficult for them. And also some do not have their parts. They left parts in school before they closed the school. So we are trying to think about ways to support our community about those issues. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Michael.
Which one? Michael Binkley?
Yes, Michael Binkley.
Good morning. It's 11, I'm saying morning because out here on the West Coast in British Columbia, it's 11:30. I am a self-represented independent artist. Stone sculpture is my forte. And I have just opened a new gallery and studio in Squamish, British Columbia, the beginning of last week. So what a time to be opening a business. Part of the interest I have with this discussion is I'm offering or intend to be offering stone sculpting workshops and the challenges that we're having here in on the West Coast, obviously for the kind of thing that I want to do is one-on-one and can't do it until this virus mess has been resolved. So I'm just more or less listening in on some of the conversations that we're having today to see how others are dealing with this situation.
Thank you. Sharon.
Yes. Hello?
There you go. Yep. Oh, no, you're off again. Go ahead. Okay. I will having trouble.
Unmute myself?
There you go. Now you're unmuted. Yeah.
My name is Sharon Stearns, and I am a playwright and artistic producer of a small theater company in the interior of British Columbia called Wishbone Theater Productions. And we were in the middle of putting on our most recent show, which was supposed to open March 28th, which we had to postpone 10 days before we opened. I produce and create shows for small communities in the interior of British Columbia. And I wanted to participate in this webinar so that I could connect with other artists and managers and creative people across the country to look at ideas on how to keep the creative spark going in my community, which is quite small, but also in the communities, artistic communities all across Canada. So that's why I'm here.
Thank you. Spark Network, is it Rachel?
Yes, hi. I'm Rachel Marks. I'm the network coordinator for SPARC, which stands for Supporting Performing Arts in Rural and Remote Communities. We are a province-wide network in Ontario. We've only been around for about 4 years. Many of our members are obviously performing artists and artist educators who offer work within the school system and classes outside of the school system. So I'm just here today to listen in and get some ideas and information to pass back to our member network.
Great, thank you. Tracy.
Hello, I'm living in Kingston, Ontario, and I'm an artist. I have a theater company called Anarch Theater, and part of our process is to offer workshops to the community as we develop our shows. We just finished our last show on March 13th, and it was a small house, so we proceeded with the performance, but really slipped by on that one. I'm also a professor at Queen's, and so a lot of the teaching has been moved online, so we're looking at that right now, and I will be co-facilitating the Kingston Arts Council Roundtable for Performing Artists next week, so I wanted to learn a bit by being here today.
Great, thank you. Vanessa.
Hey everyone, my name is Vanessa Smith, Education Outreach for the Corporation of Madison Hall in Toronto. Sorry, as soon as I start talking, my cat hops in front of these things. So with, of course, the main stage canceled as it is, all of our main stage connected programming and education outreach is just postponed until those shows are rescheduled. And we had a number of school connected workshops and things going on, and I'm currently trying to speak with those teachers about how we might be able to facilitate moving some of those online, or at least how we can help our teachers, because I also have a number of artists and artist educators who are ready and raring to work, and I'm hoping to connect some of them with classrooms. We had one program called the Lullaby Project where we were doing one-on-one songwriting workshops, and that has continued online in whatever format is best for the participant, because I didn't want to try and force a platform on anyone. They're all young mothers who are working with those songwriters. And then everything else, we're sort of in the process of what can we develop using our teaching artists and using all of our social channels and stuff to kind of create a larger community engagement during this time. And we haven't quite gotten there yet, but we've started building that skeleton. So that's where we're currently at today.
Great, thank you. I think we have heard from everyone who has their video on. Again, if you would like to take part, please do turn on your video or just send me. Is this Genevieve?
Yes, hi, I'm from the National Arts Center and was just hoping to connect with all of you and hear about what's happening in the arts environment across the country. We're working day and out with artists. Our Canada Performs platform has been really great, and I just wanted to encourage any of you who haven't applied to apply. There's now $700,000 that is being given out to support artists to perform on that platform, artists who have been out of work. And we're starting to explore now offering workshops on that platform as well for teaching artists out there. So I just wanted to share that and thank you for allowing me to listen in.
Great, thank you. And I don't think we've heard from Sophie yet.
Hi, good morning. Still morning here in Yukon. So I am with the Yukon government. Don't have an arts council in the territory, so we do all the arts funding programs as part of our government programming. So for us, it's been, we've been very fortunate to be able to announce a lot of temporary relief for the arts community and artists and one-time funding opportunities. So we're just We're just trying to put to support the community as best as we can right now. So interested to find out more about what's going on in the rest of the country. I do have to keep my video off because the bandwidth is very low here, but it's nice to see everyone.
No problem. And also someone who's having difficulty with video, Sarah, if you wanna introduce. Trying to unmute you, there you go.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you so much. Sorry, I'm having some issues with the webcam here. My name is Sarah Wong. I hold some different hats. I think us in the arts, we all have at times this issue. So I am the Artistic Director of Kickstart Disability Arts and Culture here in Vancouver. I'm on the Board of Directors as the Director of Exhibitions at the Rhodey House Museum, a historic house museum also in Vancouver. And I'm actually not really quite sure about what my employment with the Vancouver Art Gallery is right now. I'm technically laid off, but I'm still part of a lot of meetings. So I'm kind of confused as to what I do there actually. But when I did work there, I was the head of the touring pro program. I guess right now, because all of my focus is back on to Kickstart, I want to just highlight what Janelle said as well. I think during these times, it's very important to remember that the disability arts community, the disability community in general, even when everybody, you know, even before this, we had a lot of issues with isolation already. So I think this is a double layer of isolation. But so our communities and our programming right now is actually not being affected in the sense that we have a lot of resources that we can use. It's just for the physical things that we work with other galleries and spaces, we can't go to them. So we're in a position where we're doing fine, but in the other sense, we are kind of in an environment where nobody else is doing fine. So I think that's a very interesting position to be in. I just want to apologize. I didn't make it to the Vancouver, I think, like the talk that was on, like that was the first talk that you guys did, the first round table. So I'm really excited to be here today. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Sarah. And I think that's everyone. Michelle has introduced herself in the chat if you want to read more. If Michelle's welcome to speak too if she likes, but that's otherwise, yeah, we move on to Larry. Larry, if you want to move on.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much for sharing stories. I'd like to drill down a little bit because a lot of people said, well, I'm listening for ideas. And so we want to get some ideas, which could be things you've tried, things you've heard of other people doing, things you'd like to do, but it's a sort of bring out some concrete ideas. And I do want to say that you will have access to all the conversations from across the country, because we're making all of the videos available, but also, you know, Nisa and the team will be creating a report to share what ideas we come up with and suggested programs, platforms, and so on. And I do also just want to acknowledge that it is wonderful to have, this is really a pan-Canadian conversation. We've been having conversations in, for the most part, in each region of the country. And today we have basically coast to coast. So it's very exciting to have this perspective. So anyway, can we drill down? And this part of the, this part of the round table, just put your hand up either electronically with that little icon or wave, and Jennifer will see you, and she'll make sure everyone who wants to speak gets a chance. Thank you.
Yeah, so what have you been doing to kind of sustain your work over this kind of trying time, either digitally or non-digitally? What kind of methods, if anyone has any to share at this point? Yes, Julia.
Hi, yeah, so I think a lot of what people in our position are going through is trying to create content, trying to communicate with our patrons and our students, and trying to stay relevant. A lot of artists are out of work. I'm an artist as well. And so it's very hard to stay cooped up at home without work. So there is a lot of content being generated, which is amazing, online for free, just being shared between different performers with different means. But I think the difficult part for a not-for-profit organization is trying to find a way to promote that and to, you know, really celebrate that, but also try to find a way to stay open and keep our doors open and find a way to try to make enough money to pay the teachers that we have who are creating the content. So for us right now, we're trying to give back to the community. We're doing a lot of free programming just to kind of see what people are interested in and what people are able to do. Right now we're trying to figure out how we could do sort of a membership for something a little bit more exclusive. So we still do have the accessible learning for people who can't afford to donate or to pay for a membership, or who need refunds on their classes. We're offering full refunds for everybody who needs it. And I guess the membership we're trying to figure out right now is kind of like, you know, a video membership where you also get like tutorials on classes, but the instructors that you have are kind of people that you've seen on the Neptune stage in the past couple of years. So they're people that our students will recognize, our artists will recognize, and our patrons will recognize. And hopefully that way we can get some buzz happening about our theater again and get some money, I guess, really is the end goal here.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Julia. Janelle.
Hi. So what, just kind of going off of what Sarah had said before, you know, especially with people with disabilities having issues with the isolation, I found that a lot of our members have been having issues like with mental health issues with this, where they're feeling, you know, it kind of brings them back to those times when they were depressed and not able to get out of their house. So one of the things that we've been looking at doing is creating a CRIP chat group, where we're going to have offer, you know, just a general chat so people can just talk and connect and have that network so people aren't feeling so alone, but also offer chat groups where we talk specifically about art so people can feel that they're not missing out on any learning and that sort of thing. And we're looking at doing it both on Zoom and in person. In Winnipeg, we're still allowed meetings of 10 people or less. So we're looking at setting up maybe like in a park, where, you know, no more than 10 people come and we sit in a giant circle and try sharing that way. So that's kind of the, some of the things we're looking at, just to connect with people. You know, I think right now people just really need that network and that communication. And yeah, so that's kind of what we're looking at doing.
Interesting. And what kind of, Garrett. Yeah. Oh, sorry. Garrett had his hand up.
Sorry, yeah, on a similar note, we teach some youth bands that come in on Saturdays to rehearse with us, and I just sent an email this week to see if anyone's interested in still being in touch with us at all. They may rather do their own thing. They may be itching to see their bandmates again, so we're trying to put our feelers out there, and most of our students said if we do a Skype-type call every week with hard homework or not, really just to see each other's faces every week like we used to, we'll sort of bring us back to normal. When we started, you know, March break was happening. I was taking a week off. I was kind of happy to have a breather. And I'm now definitely ready to find a new normal because this is going to go on for a while. So we're trying to extend that to our students. And I think they're that's what they want right now.
Mm-hmm. Connection. Yeah, absolutely. Tracy.
Yeah. First thing I did was I bought a Yeti microphone. So to start working online, doing more audio work. And then I also, my next show is an accessibility show. So we're experimenting with how to enhance audio using Zoom, using movement interpretation. So we've moved our rehearsals online and we're just experimenting with how to complement different, how different modes of technology can complement one another. And we've also been looking into resources shared by Spiderweb Show about live streaming. So they have a really good resource available. And HowlRound has been doing this work for a while as well in the States. And they have a lot of great podcasts about moving theater and other performing arts online. So that has been helpful.
Great, thank you. Yes, Dom wanted to say something.
Yeah, hi, bonjour. Just a quick thing that I, in addition to being the translator interpreter for the Canadian Network for Arts and Learning, I'm also, I have a teaching practice where I teach French as a second language through the study of songs. And of course, all these classes were happening in real time in an actual space. And that of course has stopped like everything else. But rather than to shift the classes to a format like Zoom, which would make sense. A lot of people on social media have indicated that Zoom fatigue is now a real thing, apparently. I'm sure that Jennifer will agree with that. So instead of that, what I decided to do is to take certain aspects of my practice, which had been neglected by virtue of the format, of the live format, and focus on those things instead. So my course, Parlons Chansons, has become Parlons Chansons par Correspondance, which is a correspondence course that allows us to work on written French and grammar as opposed to the live in-person oral interaction that we usually have. So in this case, it was mostly a matter of sort of changing the paradigm of the course while still offering something that is of use and relevance to the students and that is interesting to them and that had been neglected up to that point. So sometimes it's just a matter of thinking, okay, obviously this is something I cannot do anymore, but peripheral to what I do, there's a lot of other things that I can now focus on. I know it doesn't apply to everyone, but I'm sure it applies to several of you. So I just wanted to put that out there. Thank you.
Thank you, John. I want to take that class, by the way. Sarah.
Hi, yeah, so I just wanted to say that for us especially, we're trying to figure out and we want to get some kind of consultation with Zoom because of the meetings that we've been having these weeks. We've realized that because let's say we're holding a workshop on Zoom and many of the attendees need simultaneous ASL interpretation. One issue with Zoom is that by default, and again, so just to clarify with things, there's Zoom Basic, Zoom Pro, and then there's Zoom Webinar. So we're in a position where we're using Zoom Pro. So with Zoom Pro, like with at any time, whenever somebody is speaking, the sound, it triggers Zoom to highlight whomever is speaking. And that means most of the screen will be the speaker. So the problem is that for some attendees, they need to be able to pin the ASL interpreter at all times. But then when you're doing a workshop, and a lot of the times it's not on screen, it's just in your background, it minimizes what one can see if they need multiple views. So we reached out to Zoom, and I know they're very, very busy, so they haven't gone back to us, but that's going to be something that we definitely need to figure out as we go forward. Yesterday, we also realized that there were several limitations with closed captioning. That's also something that we'll definitely need. I've been using Zoom for almost, I think, like 6 to 8 years, because some of our classes used to have to use them. So this is not new to me, and I feel like it's such a great time for them because they're finally getting the notice that they should. But for teachers, I don't know if you guys use them in different provinces, but in BC, some of my my teaching team, they use another thing called BlueJeans. Or BlueJean, I'm not quite sure. So they say that platform is much easier for secondary and primary school teaching. And then just one last thing, because I might have to go, I don't know when this meeting goes until, but just one thing is that if it helps, I just hope that everyone knows is that we're in the time of crisis. I'm not sure if we hit the peak yet, but I think it's also very important to think about what happens when we get back. I don't think anybody was really prepared for this. And there was a struggle for resources when we first got into this state of work. But I know that when we do get back, it's going to be also very chaotic, and it's also going to be a struggle. So I just feel like during this time, if anyone in your community or anyone in your kind of peer group, I just want to say that this time, there's still a lot of work to be done. And I just feel like once we do get back to work, it's always going to be whoever is most prepared is going to be able to kind of rise to the top and get more resources. So if that is, I hope that helps anyone who's a little bit down right now, but we're working very hard, and we are very grateful to be in an industry where everyone else is also struggling, but still planning for the best. So. Yeah, thank you.
Interesting. Yes, thank you. Janelle.
Yeah, I just wanted to speak back about the ASL and the Zoom thing, because that is something that we have looked into and contacted Zoom about. It wasn't our organization, it's one that we're partnering with. And we're having our first ASL panel Zoom thing tomorrow afternoon. So if these talks continue next week, I'll be able to report back and let you guys know the best way to use ASL with Zoom and that sort of thing. And I'll leave my email in the chat group just in case we don't meet again. Then people can just email me directly, and I'll give you an update and let you know how it all worked out.
Great. Thank you. Good luck with that. Hopefully it works out. Anyone else have something? Yes, Kim.
Just to mute myself here. I think one of the things we're experiencing is we're having a lot of people suggesting, do online this and do virtual that. And I mean, we are gonna run an online course, but at the same time, we're a building, and we really focus on connection and community. And as much as we want to help people connect during this time, we don't want to move our entire platform online and then negate the value of what we have to offer in the community with people actually getting together and, you know, touching the paints together and that kind of involvement. So I think we're trying to strike that balance of survive and stay relevant, but not undervalue what we have to offer in non-crisis times. And the other thing that I would love to hear from anyone from this group, if anyone has found a great resource for doing music rehearsals as a Zoom alternative. As we know, the slight lag in Zoom makes music rehearsals next to impossible. So if anybody's found an online resource that would allow a choral group to sing or people to make music together, we're very eager to hear about it.
Yes, has anyone encountered anything? Yes, Tracy, did you have something? Yeah. Sorry, I'll... trying to unmute you, it's not working.
Okay, sorry. Jam Kazam is what was suggested. J-A-M-K-A-Z-A-M. And what I gather though is it's best if you have an Ethernet connection, so you're not using your Wi-Fi. It has to do with the bit speed, like the speed of, hold on. This is a big chat about exactly this. 35 MS is only good for banjo. Anyway, so you have to have a good connection and the best is to be plugged in, and Jam Kazam was the best they found so far. So
that's interesting.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. Yes, we've heard this, I think, at almost every single one of these meetings, people are asking about that. Something that we have, I guess we could mention this now, is that Caitlin has been compiling a list of resources putting them. We have a page online where they're all listed. So things that you're talking about right now, Jam Kazam one and Blue Jean potentially, I'm sure Caitlin is capturing all of these things and she's putting them on this list of resources. And go ahead, Caitlin.
Yeah, pretty much exactly what Jennifer just said. I'm capturing all of the ideas and suggestions you guys have for digital platforms, and I'm compiling them onto this document that's basically changing every single day at this point. In addition to the digital resources, though, there's also information about funding, emergency funding for artists or people in the arts community. And there's also some like skill sharing type websites where you can do like little like workshops and classes, either yourself or with your kids or whatever. So there's a little bit of everything in that document. It's all organized. And if you have anything that you want to contribute, let me know. I'll put my email in the convo box and that'd be great to hear from you. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Caitlin. There was one, I'm just looking now at the list. Oh, there was one that has been also suggested. It was developed by the conservatory called Cadenza. I don't know if anyone has tried that one, but I don't know how that, I know that was specifically created for music. So could be worth a thought. I don't know if anybody's tried it yet, but yeah, anyone else have something to add as far as what they're working on right now or how they're sustaining their work, not even necessarily in digital? Yesterday we had a great conversation with English Quebec. People are going around talking about things that they're doing in person, so we have a little bit of that with in Winnipeg, doing 10 people or less, but people going around and doing performances on the street for their neighbors, etc. I don't know, yeah, if anyone else has anything else to add at this particular topic. If not, we'll throw it back to Larry.
Hey, thank you. It's interesting because I really appreciate that everyone is taking a very professional attitude towards this. How can we do what we want, what we're trying to do? How can we help our people? So my question that I'd like to just slip in here is referring back to what Sarah said, if people are feeling a little bit down, or Janelle talked about the mental health issues. So just how is this affecting you personally as you try to do what you're doing? What kind of kind of mental state do you find yourself in? What are the issues you're dealing with personally, you as the one who's responsible?
Yes, Sarah.
So first of all, thank you for asking. I mean, I don't think anyone asked this. And, you know, I come from a lot of privilege and I tend to always think like, you know, at this time, you know, who needs the immediate help? And there are times when I know we are a lot of arts folks here, but there are times when in my head, I'm just like, I shouldn't complain because I'm not a doctor or I'm not kind of, you know, the front of scene on like the healthcare side. But I think just even hearing that, I don't think I'll ever get asked that ever again in my life. So thanks for the opportunity to even, but the thing is I feel like I'm being like pushed and it's not anyone's fault but my own. I feel like I'm constantly on, you know how there was the fear that if we work from home, you won't work from home. But then when we first started this week of work from home, we realized that we were not just going from nine to five and commuting back home, but we're working from 9 to maybe like 12 at night, day after day. Because to be honest with you, I like sitting in my own basement and working, and there's little distraction and you get a lot done. But I just feel like in the very beginning few weeks, I felt like there was no direction from lots of places. And I just felt like there was a scramble to kind of stay relevant, and you're going to be the first one that does the webinar, or you're going to be the first one to get everyone, you know? So I just feel like it felt like everybody, yeah, was scrambling. And that's why I fear that when we do have the directive to go back to work, it's going to be another round of struggling. So, but I just feel at the same time for everyone, in this meeting, we provide a public service, and I think, I don't know how ethics works here in Canada, but I went to school in the States, and museum ethics and art ethics, it's so important. It all comes back to the public good. So I think that, I mean, do what you can, but you can only do what you can if you take care of yourself. And, you know, your ability to take care of yourself will also, you know, reflect on how others in society could benefit from that. But I just want to say, I so appreciate what each of you guys are doing. And it's such an honor to even be a part of this industry, even though we're so far, far apart in a physical sense. But I'm doing great. In fact, like the layoff that I am a part of for one of the institutions, I was ecstatic because I'm just like, as long as you let me know, I now can take up the 5 hours a day that I work for this, and I could just work on other things for the other or organizations. So in my opinion, I have a lot to do still, and I'm just really, really excited, which is kind of weird, but yeah. And I would like to hear what everyone else thinks as well. Thanks.
Thank you. Vanessa. All right, we're working against each other with the mute. Go ahead, unmute yourself.
Okay, great. I was gonna wait, but it gave me a pop-up. Yeah, a lot of what Sarah said was really applicable in that. Thank you for, I feel like for the first couple of weeks, who took this and were able to immediately content, and I felt this like same, but did not have the personal capacity to do so within the first week and a half at least of just kind of like dealing with my own personal reelings about what was going on. And I feel like I've also been fortunate to be surrounded by our teaching artists who seem to be more of the content side than I was able to be, and having some really constructive conversations with them about what they wanted to do in this time, because I didn't have the same creative capacity I often do to help steer that, was really helpful in us deciding what our next steps were going to be going forward. And also the concept of the fact that, like, we all know now at this point that this is a marathon, not a sprint. And I think a lot of those places and people who are able to really be content at the very beginning might start experiencing some burnout, and then there's going to be some places for some of us who took a little bit longer to get our processes going and get everything organized, we'll be able to come in and present that content. And also, like, it's a marathon, we've all got a long time to be at home, we've got a lot of time to develop some different ideas and some different strategies about things, and to not be too hard on ourselves if we didn't quite get that immediately out the gate or be the first one to do that. And I think that's sort of the how I've been trying to position things for myself going forward into at least this week and feeling a lot better about not being like immediately there.
Great, thank you. Julia.
Yeah, so I guess for me, it's been very stressful. I started as a teacher with the Neptune Theater, actually started as a student, and then I became a teaching assistant, worked my way up, became a lead instructor, and then camp director, and then got this position. I've also been a front of house member. I've been on stage at Neptune. I've worked reception. Like, I have my hand in every desk I can get my hand. That sounds awful. But anyways, you know what I mean. But it's been very, very hard to still be working while a bunch of the people that I've worked with for years and years are being laid off around you. And going from a teaching position into an administrative position, like, I had to be one of the people to say, we don't have work for you at this time, we're laying you all off, when it really could have been like any number of the people I'm working with who could be in my position right now. So that's a very hard thing to deal with. But yeah, I did just find out today that I'm not in the next round of layoffs, so that's great. And it kind of gives me and my boss is Laura Caswell. She's the director of education. So we're kind of looking at things in a 30, 60, 90 day plan. So it's been very hard not knowing, like, am I going to be here for 90 days? Like, are we planning something as a duo that we can tag team, that we can really like sink our teeth into for the next 60 days? Or am I going to be gone next week and then Laura's having to do all of this on her own? So now today is kind of like the first day where we're in a better headspace where we're just like, okay, like, I know I'm going to be here for the next month. Okay, like, what can we do in the next month, the two of us? And just kind of, I don't know, it's kind of felt like a fight to stay relevant, sort of. So it's a little stressful, but it has been good news today. So now it's kind of like, okay, what can we do next? How do we keep the ball rolling?
Thank you, Julia. Kirstie.
Some others have said, but I, fortunately, I think really early on, and a couple weeks ago as this was starting to happen, recognized that this would be, as was noted, a marathon. Something I've shared with my staff, and I want to, if you need somebody to give you this permission as well, please allow me to do that, is that there's no expectation for myself or for them to meet a certain number of hours in the week or be online for this 7-8 hours a day. I'm really encouraging them, and I'm trying to do this for myself too, to, you know, go for walks, or if you need to watch Netflix for an hour just to stop thinking about COVID for a little while, do that. You know, if you need to take care of a situation with your family or go get groceries, do that. So, you know, we take very seriously the work that we're doing. We want to do that work, but as noted, I mean, this is an endurance measure, right? We're going to have to, if we're going to serve our community well, we have to still be doing this 6 weeks from now, right? So so I'm just extending that grace to all of you, and I hope that you're feeling that support from those that you're working with and employed by. But I really think that's the only way that we're going to not only take care of ourselves, but also continue to do the work that we're going to do, is by allowing ourselves that grace to not be at what we think should be a 100% kind of productivity right now.
Good point. Yes, thank you. Does anyone else have anything to add to this, Larry's last question or previous question, most recent question? Okay, Larry, I think we've hit it.
Okay, good. Thank you. Yeah, thank you very much. And we're all doing, I mean, I'm in touch with colleagues around the world. It's like, yeah, in New Zealand, they're locked down. In Australia, they're locked down. And in Holland, they're locked down. It's amazing. The whole world is having to deal with this. And yet, each of us, or it may be two or three people or a family like Jennifer's, each of us is facing it by ourselves. Like, it's so strange. And that's why I think we get so much underlying anxiety, because we're sort of in these little isolated boxes. I would like to just push on something. I'm not sure who, somebody already raised this issue. And this conversation tends to be very circular, but can you speak a little bit more about how you try to do what you're doing as much as you can do? Is there something you've been able to do to help alleviate the situation for other people, maybe your clients or students, or maybe your colleagues, or I don't know. Is there some way that the arts have been able to be applied, or the work that you do in the arts has been applied or could be applied to facilitate people getting through this, alone or together?
Yes, Sarah.
I guess for that question, so for my different hats, I think one thing that was really pivotal for me was last week I was in a meeting with the director of STEM Gallery, which is here in Vancouver. They mostly do LGBTQ plus exhibitions and work. And when we were discussing an exhibition, they were saying that they are refusing to lay anyone off. Like, they will fight tooth and nail to the last cent, but they are not doing it. And then for my institution, for Rhodey House Museum, we're also fighting to not lay anyone off. And that means, in a way, taking up more work as a volunteer board member, or that means giving some more of your time without being paid. I think it's very important because most of the people that I work with or work in my team are auxiliary staff or casual staff. And when we were back at, a normal period, just advocating for them has already been very hard. They don't get benefits. They don't, have set hours of work. Their work is precarious. So I think right now, even if the advocacy doesn't go anywhere, it's documented. It needs to be brought up. I was told that in some of my other work and meetings that I was being very annoying because I was, saying, don't forget, we still have workers to pay and stuff like that. And one line that I will not cross is I will not ask our artists or our staff to work without pay. So that to me is my own ethical guideline that I cannot cross. And I've put my job on the line in my bigger institution because I refused to allow that to happen. I really want everyone to think about intersections. There are those who are going to be hit a lot more hard because of this, financially, emotionally. And it is very important that now, even though we cannot in many situations, to remember the optics of it, of asking work to not be paid, of asking artists or asking groups that are traditionally, historically exploited for labor to not be paid. So, so for me, I think, because my work is advocacy based anyway, it is just a lot more. It's calling up the governments, it's calling up our local institutions and organizations and making sure, are you laying off? Are you paying? Just making sure that we kind of check and balance each other. And I think that that's something that small and medium or organizations really do very, very well. So for me, it's a matter of wage, of proper usage of labor. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Julia.
Yeah, so we're doing a ton of things to connect and try to help people as much as possible. First and foremost, throughout the theater school, March was like our insane busy month. So we had March break camps that we had to cancel, our spring Saturday classes, which have over 180 students. They were supposed to start on March 28th. March 25th was the first day of our school tour, which was going to go out for 3 months all over Nova Scotia. And then we had a PD day camp at the end of March and one at the beginning of April. So we had to cancel absolutely everything. And we've kept in really good touch with parents because we know, like, I'm not a parent myself. My boss is not a parent. Many of the teachers I work with are not parents as well. But we do understand and have a really good relationship with our students and the parents. So we've made sure that they know like what the free programming we're doing, like our 14-day theater kid challenge, which is curriculum based, like 7 pages of creative work and exercises and games for their kids to play every day, and like performer challenges, which are online as well, and it's all free. And we've offered them the option of having like fully refunded classes, which normally we would charge an admin fee if they're canceled or whatever. But everyone has been super supportive, really appreciative. We had a parent who started a GoFundMe page for our March break teachers, so we've been sharing that like crazy. We also have one of our teachers is a member of the Mi'kmaq Friendship Center, and he's going to be doing a big challenge through them as well, and he's asked us for support, so we're going to be supporting him throughout this. Along with that, we're going to be getting in touch with our Pride community, like members of our queer community, and the Black Cultural Center here in Nova Scotia, and just to kind of see like what can we all do together, and how can we support you. So we want to make sure that we're staying relevant, but that we're also like reaching out to the people who are feeling this in different ways, but the same kind of ways, if that makes sense. And we're doing a teen Instagram takeover. So we're going to be giving some of our most senior students, who a lot of them actually just got into Sheridan College, so they're very excited and nervous. And we're going to be giving them free rein to take over the Instagram account and just kind of show what they're going through, and maybe do some fun theater stuff just to kind of keep spirits up. And finally, I'll say one of the things that we're planning to do is a teacher video to send out to all the parents. So it'll just be a quick little minute long of all of our instructors saying hi to their students and just a familiar face, just to kind of give the kids a bit of normalcy, just so that they know, like, hey, my teacher that I see every Saturday is doing okay, and they can't wait to see me again. So, because we do have a lot of return students. So I think that's kind of what we're trying to do to help everybody.
Thanks, Julia. Yeah, Garrett.
Yeah. Oops. Am I on? We just decided this morning we're doing an Instagram takeover next week, and also we've already sent invitations to our students to sign up for their lessons online and fill out a little survey and keep in touch with us. We've had about a 25% response rate on that, which we said was actually pretty good considering the amount of information we're all getting inundated with. We're going to follow that up one more time with a personal video from their teacher saying, hey, we miss you, we want to hear that you're practicing at home, all this stuff. Because a faceless admin person saying, please sign up, we care about you so much, is so much different than your teacher being, hey man, I miss you, I used to see you every Tuesday morning, and now I haven't seen you in so long. So yeah, great idea.
Great, thank you. Anyone else on how they're reaching their community? And some really good comments are happening in the chat. I don't know if you're following along, but there's lots of kind of concerns about paying artists and qualifying for the CERB at this point. I know I've been hearing about that a lot, even outside of these conversations. I know a lot of people are trying to navigate that. Does anyone have anything to add about that, or any kind of thoughts on that, or any other kind of monetizing efforts that you've done at this point with your with either your arts and learning or your art form in general? Yes, Kiersey.
Just a quick note to say that sort of conflict between the CERB and payment to artists has come up for us already. With we've been hiring local artists to help us co-facilitate these roundtables we want to do. And what we've done in one instance where there was that concern is sort of agreed to delay payment so that the artist will invoice us, and so it's written in our contract, sort of a timeline for that, but so that won't interfere potentially with CERB. I mean, it's a temporary kind of measure, but we're hoping that that'll at least alleviate anxiety around that for the time being, so that there's still a promise made and it's still in a contract for that payment to happen. But of course, we want to get funding into people's hands now, so this is not necessarily ideal, but at least there's something in place there.
Mm-hmm. Great idea. Great idea. And as you have seen, what we as a network are doing, we're having these roundtable discussions, which so far this is the last one of this series, but we may be offering more. We may be offering webinars. We're going to be talking about this next week and seeing what our next steps are. And we have a number of resources on our site for the community. As Caitlin has shared that page, we also have an entire kind of a searchable database of funding opportunities in general, not to do with this emergency situation, as well as obviously Canada's map of arts and learning. And we're looking at increasing its capacity, I guess, to talk more about which artists are teaching online, have that available. So if you're not on Canada's map of arts and learning, do encourage you to get on that as well. And we also want to know what else that we can do for you, for the sector, during this time and even moving forward, of course. And so if anyone has any ideas for us as far as how we can help you with the work that you're doing, if anyone has any right now, that'd be great. Raise your hand, let me know. We're also going to be sending out a post, a survey after this to see kind of your thoughts on this discussion, as well as with that question as well. What else can we help you with at this point, or what other things would be useful for you that we could potentially offer as a relatively small organization with limited resources ourselves, but we are trying to do, service you as best as we can, service the sector. Does anyone else have anything, just as we're wrapping up here, anything else to add or any final thoughts that they wanna say at this point? Okay, well, Larry, if you wanted to.
Well, thank you very much. And don't forget that we do want to know your ideas on where we might put our energies in the coming weeks. But thank you very much for participating. It's been, to me, very rewarding, I think maybe to all of us, to be able to do these sessions. And I think as you do your own work and you reach out and you'll find that it's rewarding. It's wonderful to feel that you're doing something in this weird and unprecedented time to help other people, to help our field. So thank you, and we'll continue to be in touch.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks so much. Bye-bye. Stay healthy.
Stay healthy, yeah.